In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. My Lord and my God, I firmly believe that you are here, that you see me, that you hear me. I adore you with profound reverence. I ask your pardon for my sins and the grace to spend this time of prayer fruitfully. My Immaculate Mother, Saint Joseph, my Father and Lord, my guardian angel, intercede for me. The first reading of today's Mass takes us once more to the magnificent scene that we had contemplated a couple of Sundays ago, of the chosen people at the very doors of the Promised Land. And Moses, with Joshua, is speaking to them. And as we read in the Navarre Bible, this book that we had been consulting all this time, after recalling the main events in Israel's journey from Sinai, Horeb, Mount Horeb, where God had given them the Decalogue shortly after leaving Egypt, not even a month into the journey, onwards through the Sinai Peninsula for 40 years, during which divine providence was so evident. Now Moses stresses the privileged position of the Hebrew people. They had been chosen by God from among all the nations of the earth and drawn to him in a close relationship of filiation quite beyond the experience of the Gentiles. And we read from the book of Deuteronomy. Moses said to the people, "Now Israel, hear the statutes and decrees that I am teaching you to observe, that you may live and may enter and take possession of the land which the Lord, the God of your fathers, is giving to you. In your observance of the commandments of the Lord your God, which I enjoin upon you, you shall not add to what I command you, nor subtract from it. Observe them carefully, for thus will you give evidence of your wisdom and intelligence to the nations, who will hear of all these statutes and say, 'This great nation is truly a wise and intelligent people.' For what great nation is there that has God so close to it as the Lord our Lord is to us whenever we call upon him? Or what great nation has the statutes and decrees that are as just as this whole law which I am setting before you today?" This passage, which belongs to what in scripture science or the study of scripture is called the genre of wisdom writings. They're not exactly historical events. They're not poetry either, like the Psalms. They're wisdom writings. Many of the prophets were that, and this one is too, in the sense that it gives it gives wisdom. It sets forth the reality of things as God revealed them to us. In other words, God equipped man with an intellect, with an intelligence capable of understanding the nature of things, the natural order, that is. But because of original sin, because of the remnants of that disorder of our first parents, then our intellect is now prone to error. Unlike the intellect of Adam and Eve, the pure intellect of our first parents, which had a natural, shall we say, gravitational pull towards reality. And so therefore, they attained the truth almost invariably. And there's a reason why there's that passage in Genesis where God made the animals parade in front of Adam. And then it says there, whatever name he called them, that was their name. In the language of scripture, as we had considered many times in the past, a name enshrines the essence of a thing. So to name something correctly means to have an accurate concept, an accurate understanding of what that thing is. It's not a mirage, it's not an error, it's the truth. And our first parents were drawn to that. That's the reason why the first sin was so serious, because it was not a mistake. They knew what they were doing, and freely they did it. They rebelled against the goodness of God. You can just imagine the gravity of the malice of the devil, who even saw things more clearly still, and still did what he did. Well, anyway, what Moses is telling the people now of Israel was, because of the law that had been given to them, because of that divine positive law, that revelation of the nature of things and their own nature, they had in their hands, or in their intellect, an understanding of the reality of things and their own reality that should enable them to behave accordingly. Because at the end of the day, morality is not a mystery. It's just doing what's right. Doing what we understand is in accord with our nature, and avoiding that which is not. There should be no mystery in that, if not for the fact that we have original sin and our intellect has been damaged. But for God to give them the Ten Commandments, come out with what is called the divine positive law of natural things, but divinely revealed. Of course, on top of that, God will reveal supernatural realities, his own nature, the nature of grace, and also in a supernatural way. But to have that kind of a revelation with them, of course, put them at the level above all the other nations. And that exactly was their role, as it is our role. So this passage, which belongs to the genre of wisdom writings, served as an advance exhortation to fidelity to the law, which would be clearly recorded in the next two chapters of Deuteronomy. The main argument is made in favor of fidelity to the law by alluding to the fact that God was so near his people and so accessible to them. In other words, for the chosen people, God was not a distant and perhaps indifferent God, like the God of the modern days and the Freemasons. Rather, the God of Israel was a provident and loving father who was readily accessible to his children and who took care of their daily needs, down to the daily manna and quail that they had for decades. Thus, what Moses was calling the Israelites to was fidelity to the covenant with God. Not just any commitment to any law, any subservience to a supreme being, but one of filiation, the relationship of children with their father. One who does justice will live in the presence of the Lord. Whoever walks blamelessly and does justice, who thinks the truth in his heart and slanders not with his tongue, who harms not his fellow men, nor takes up reproach against his neighbor, by whom the reprobate is despised, while he honors those who fear the Lord, who lends not his money at usury and accepts no bribe against the innocent. Whoever does these things shall never be disturbed. The responsorial psalm of the Mass breaks out in joyful acknowledgement of the blessedness of whoever holds true to that covenant. And the reason is beautifully expressed in the second reading, this time from the first letter of St. James, when he says, "Dearest brothers and sisters, all good giving and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no alteration or shadow caused by change. He willed to give us birth by the word of truth, that we may be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. Humbly welcome the word that has been planted in you and is able to save your souls. Be doers of the word and not hearers only, deluding yourselves." The Decalogue was not something imposed from outside of man. Rather, it was a supernatural revelation of a natural truth of man's nature and that of the universe around him. That comes, as we read, as a birth by the word of truth, like a birth in us of something supernatural, something divine, God's word, God's idea, God's design that permeates the whole of creation. St. Thomas Aquinas would years later explain it as a participation of natural reason in the eternal law of God. It's like, of course, God is eternal. God is transcends everything that he had created. In God's mind, all the possibilities were there. And of all of those possibilities, what he loved, he gave being to, and that's what creation is. So in other words, there must be a logic, a reason, rhyme and rhythm in creation. As a matter of fact, the philosopher's observation of that in the universe around him is one of the ways for proving the existence of a supreme being, because such harmony, such symphony of the whole universe cannot be uncaused. It must have a cause, an uncaused cause, and that is what we call God. Well, the rational intellect, our intellect, limited as it may be, has a natural aptitude to participate, partem capere in Latin, to take part in, that's what participate means, to have a part in that divine plan. To the extent that we're in on it, that's the way we can function properly. And to the extent that we don't know it, that's the way we blunder, we muck around, because precisely we don't know. By the way, the fact that the animals and the plants and the planets and the minerals all seem to follow that plan, that's the foundation of all the physical sciences, why we can study them, why they're so predictable, because they follow. The fact that they do, and they're not intelligent, you gotta wonder how come. It's again one of the demonstrations of the existence of a supreme being who must have programmed it to them or in them to behave that way. You know, every time I look at the periodic table, especially for a chemist, you know, that's not just a table there. There are things under that: orbitals, quantum theory, the Aufbau Prinzip, the building principle of filling up those orbitals, which are really nothing but, I don't know what, calculations of minimum states. I'm sorry, got into that again. But every time I look at the periodic table, I marvel at the author behind it. And I remember once again, a teacher of mine in physiology, biochemistry. Was not even Catholic. She was a Protestant from Silliman University. But a great mind. And in the midst of a complicated set of equations, making use of two blackboards, she turns around and says, "Class, it's not possible to study these things and not believe in God." And then just turn around and continue with her equations. You know, it's no wonder why that Department of Chemistry of UP produced so many people I know who are dedicated souls, members of Opus Dei even, priests even. It's amazing. In this very house where I'm staying right now, there are four chemists, two of them from US universities with PhDs, including me, because that's what happens when science is untrammeled by vice, when science is true science and not a pseudoscience trying to do theology. It opens itself to the infinite. And that's what the Decalogue was for the chosen people. The divine positive law is something akin to a user's manual that comes with the product. It's not something that the user should consider burdensome and much less an imposition, but rather a welcome gift from the manufacturer. that makes it easier for him to optimize the use of the product. Herein lies the reason for the moral superiority of the chosen people. Despite their backwardness in most other things, in the physical sciences, for example, in construction, in civilization, even in culture, compared to the Gentiles around them who already had cities, great civilizations, where they were just nomads. Nevertheless, those peoples with their superior civilization had to contend with the limitations of the natural intellect that had been clouded besides by sin, to grapple with the question of what was right and what was wrong. And that's the reason why they fell into all kinds of moral aberrations, slavery, divorce, abortions, the unnatural use of women, the unnatural use of men, you name it. They had all kinds of things. All you need to do is watch Netflix. On the other hand, the chosen people had the Decalogue to show them the way. The difference was akin to that between learning how to use a gadget by trial and error and having a user's manual to start with. All these come to a head in the gospel reading. When we read from St. Mark, when the Pharisees with some scribes who had come from Jerusalem gathered around Jesus, they had come from Jerusalem going all the way to Capernaum to observe him, to spy on him. They observed that some of his disciples ate their meals with unclean, that is, unwashed hands. Because the Pharisees, and in fact all the Jews, did not eat without carefully washing their hands, keeping the tradition of the elders. So the Pharisees and scribes questioned him, "Why do your disciples not follow the tradition of the elders, but instead eat a meal with unclean hands?" And he responded, "Well, did Isaiah prophesy about you, hypocrites? As it is written, these people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching as doctrine human precepts. You disregard God's commandments, but cling to human tradition." Because that's what the Pharisees had done. From the Ten Commandments, which were pretty straightforward, but fundamental, essential, they had come up with more than 600 precepts, external practices, which were really nothing but ways of circumventing the fundamentals, giving the appearance of observance in order for them to do what they wanted. In moral theology, there is a phenomenon called the Pharisaical conscience, which is a deformation of conscience that leads one to consider something of less importance to be important, while belittling the importance of something that is really important. And this is best illustrated by the incidents that we are considering now. The Pharisees were putting so much importance to the external observances of the law that they themselves had fabricated through the centuries by way of human tradition, practices, while glossing over the more important demands of the Decalogue, earning for themselves our Lord's strong rebuke. "These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching as doctrines human precepts. You disregard God's commandments, but cling to human tradition." An example of this deformation is the ongoing controversy or controversy regarding what some quarters have been presenting as the mishandling by Pope Francis of several important issues besetting the church. For example, his perceived welcoming attitude to divorced and remarried Catholics as regards the reception of Holy Communion, or his perceived openness to same-sex unions, or his perceived clampdown on the Trident in Mass and on the Lefebvre movement, etc., etc. Aside from the character of armchair politicians that many of these critics display, trying to solve the problems of the church from the comfort of their armchair, not knowing the real situation, the strongest objection to their position, of course, is their lack of complete information regarding the problems that they are judging. Meanwhile, other ecclesiastical problems are festering in their own circumscriptions, in their own backyard. How many such staunch Catholics are actually that consistent in their Catholicity? As our Lord already pointed out, how can somebody obsess about the speck in his brother's eye when he has a whole beam in his own eye? It's all too easy to focus on one aspect of the faith, blowing it out of proportion, while neglecting so many other aspects which are even more important. Our Lord pointed out to the Jews the futility of observing external practices for legal purity, while neglecting to observe the internal dispositions for moral, genuine purity. He was pointing out the same thing, or rather, he is pointing out the same thing to us now. Because we're living in a world where appearances have taken over reality to the point of people even calling it virtual reality. Either it's reality or it's not. That word virtual there is excess. Our Lord could not be clearer. And again, we continue our reading of the gospel. Hear me, all of you. And understand, nothing that enters one from outside can defile that person, but the things that come from within are what defile. Because from within people, from their hearts, come evil thoughts, unchastity, theft, murder, adultery, greed, malice, deceit, licentiousness, envy, blasphemy, arrogance, folly. All these evils come from within, and they defile a man. My brothers and sisters, our Lord touches the very core of the moral life, which is the orientation of the person's will as the principle of his decisions, his words, and his actions. The external factors affecting him are not decisive, although they may affect the genesis of his will, the genesis of his decision. What is decisive is the interior act of his will. And that's what ultimately matters. Either that will is oriented towards God or towards himself. The former, orientation towards God, leads to eternal life of union with God. The latter leads to eternal damnation of utter egoism, which, as we have seen in the past, is the essence of hell. Our Lord underlined the primacy of the moral object and the intention in the determination of the morality of any human act. It's not the circumstances. Nothing that enters one from the outside can defile that person, our Lord said. But rather the moral object and the intention, the quality, the directionality of that act in itself, considered in itself, plus the directionality that the subject, the doer, is taking, that's his intention. Those are the things that come from within, and they're what can defile a man. Because as the Lord declared too, from within people, from their hearts, come evil thoughts, unchastity, theft, murder, adultery, greed, malice, deceit, licentiousness, envy, blasphemy, arrogance, folly. All these evils come from within, and they defile a man. On the other hand, what makes a person good is the action of God in his soul, as the gospel acclamation also declares, the Father gave us birth by his message of truth, that we might be as the first fruits of his creation. Such action of God, however, is made manifest with the moral life of that person. Again, as the Apostle James declared in the second reading, when he says, be doers of the word and not hearers only, deluding yourselves. Religion that is pure and undefiled before God and the Father is this, to care for orphans and widows in their affliction and to keep oneself unstained from the world. In other words, it's true that it's God who sanctifies us from within. But the proof that that has taken place or is taking place is what we say and do. It's not a matter of feeling that God is sanctifying us. If he's really sanctifying us, we must do holy things, right? We have to walk the talk. Operatio sequitur naturam, operations follow nature. If our fallen nature has really been healed by grace, if God has really elevated us to a state of divine sonship, then it should show the way in the way we talk, in the way we think, in the way we act. Otherwise, it's all fake. All these are summed up in the prayer of the collect of today's Mass. And with this, we can end. God of might, giver of every good gift, put into our hearts the love of your name, so that by deepening our sense of reverence, you may nurture in us what is good, and by your watchful care, keep safe what you have nurtured. You have a few minutes left to finish the prayer.